Hello students, today's online lecture is on the topic Physiology of Liver, Gallbladder and Exocrine Pancreas. In today's class, we will be learning in detail about physiological anatomy of liver, gallbladder and pancreas. Then we will see the functions of liver and gallbladder. Then in brief about the composition, functions, secretion and regulation of the pancreatic juice. And lastly, I will also briefly discuss about the various applied aspects of liver and gallbladder. So let us start today's session. Before going into the deep physiological aspects of how liver and gallbladder functions, let us get a brief anatomical knowledge about the organs. Liver is the largest gland in human body that weighs about 1.5 kg. Traditionally, it is divided into a right lobe that includes the caudate and quadrate lobes and a left lobe. Functionally, these lobes are independent parts and called as portal lobes that are approximately equal in size and have their own blood supply and lymphatic drainage. The liver has got considerable physiological reserve and regeneration power. It simply means that even if you remove 80% of the liver tissues, even then all the physiological functions of liver will accomplish normally. And also liver can easily regenerate back to its original volume in 6 to 8 weeks of resection of a part of it. In this diagram, you can have a quick idea about the gross anatomy of the liver. This is a back view of the organ. Here on the right side, you can see the right lobe that includes the caudate and the quadrate lobe. And on the left side, you can see the left lobe. Now, let us see the structural characteristics of liver. The liver is made up of about 1 lakh hexagonal areas that forms the hepatic lobules. Here on the left side, you can see a detailed diagram showing the structural as well as histological characteristics of liver and hepatic lobules. Hepatic lobule is a honeycomb-like structure made up of hepatocytes. These hepatocytes are arranged in columns to form hepatic plates. Each hepatic plate is made up of two columns of hepatocytes in between these two columns lies the bile canaliculi. Now, in between two adjacent hepatic plates, sinusoids are present. These sinusoids open into the central vein present in the center of each hepatic lobule and are lined by special macrophagic cells known as Kupffer cells. Along the periphery of each hepatic lobule are present portal triads. These portal triads contain a branch of portal vein, a branch of hepatic artery, and a branch of bile duct. So, the bile, which is a digestive juice, is secreted by the hepatocytes and then emptied into the bile canaliculi of the hepatic lobules, and from where it goes to the bile duct and is stored in the gallbladder for future use. Hepatic circulation means the blood supply to the liver. Liver is supplied by two structures, namely the portal vein and the hepatic artery. The portal vein provides around 75 to 80% of the deoxygenated blood that comes from the stomach, intestine, spleen and pancreas, whereas the hepatic artery supplies around 20 to 25% of blood. The liver receives about 1.5 liter blood per minute from the above two sources. Liver has got both intra and extrahepatic biliary apparatus. The extrahepatic biliary apparatus consists of gallbladder and the extrahepatic bile ducts. Now, the first is gallbladder. Gallbladder is a pear-shaped sac lying under the surface of the liver that stores the bile. Second is Second component of extrahepatic biliary apparatus are the ducts that carry the bile. These ducts are hepatic duct, cystic duct, and the common bile duct. Now, hepatic ducts are two in number, the right and left hepatic duct, that emerges from the respective lobes of the liver. These two ducts join together to form a common hepatic duct. Second duct is the cystic duct. It is of length 4 cm and it connects the neck of gallbladder to the common hepatic duct to form the common bile duct. The last is the common bile duct. It is about 8 cm in length and joins the pancreatic duct to become the hepatopancreatic duct, also known as the ampulla of water. From this ampulla of water, the bile which is secreted is released into the duodenum on demand basis. Now, let us see in detail about the functions of liver and its secretion, bile. Liver is involved in many biochemical functions of the body. The first set of functions of liver is secretory functions. Liver cells act as an exocrine gland and continuously secrete bile. Bile is very important for digestion and absorption of fats. The second set of functions of liver is metabolic functions. Liver is the key organ and main site where the metabolism of all kinds of carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins take place. Thus, let us see each metabolic functions of liver one by one. Firstly, the role of liver in carbohydrate metabolism. Liver acts as a glucostat organ and in three ways. First is by process of glycogenesis. Glycogen is formed from glucose and is stored in the liver. Second is by process of glycogenolysis. Liver converts the liver glycogen into glucose. And third, by the process of gluconeogenesis, glucose is formed from the non-carbohydrate sources like amino acids. Now, liver is the main site of alcohol metabolism also, as the hepatocytes contain the enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase necessary for the reaction to take place. Now let us see the role of liver in fat metabolism. Both degradation and synthesis of fat occurs inside liver. Liver contains enzyme lipoprotein lipase, which hydrolyzes triglycerides, cholesterol, and phospholipids into fatty acids. Liver is the site of beta oxidation, where oxidation of fatty acids into acetoacetic acid occurs. Synthesis of triglycerides, cholesterol, phospholipids, and various types of lipoproteins and chylomicrons all take place in the liver. Now let us see role of liver in protein metabolism. Liver causes deamination of amino acids, which is important for the production of energy in the body. Liver is the main site of urea formation also and a main site for the formation of all non-essential amino acids. Now, the next set of functions performed by liver is the protective and detoxicating functions. Liver contains Kupffer cells that helps to remove bacteria and other foreign bodies from the portal circulation. Liver also detoxifies certain drugs. The fourth function of liver is storage. Liver stores glucose in the form of glycogen for use in the future. It also stores vitamin B12, vitamin A, and 60% of the excess of iron which is formed in the form of ferritin. The next function of liver is excretory functions. Liver is the only site where ammonia is converted into urea. Ammonia is very harmful to the body. The synthetic functions of liver involves: liver is the site of synthesis of plasma proteins, especially albumin. It also synthesizes some clotting factors, namely fibrinogen, and clotting factors 5, 7, 9, and 10. liver synthesizes special enzymes called as alkaline phosphatase that are useful indicators of the normal working condition of the liver. Other miscellaneous functions are: liver acts as a reservoir of blood and approximately stores about 650 ml of blood. Liver is the site of destruction of RBCs and it helps in the inactivation of some hormones like insulin, glucagon, cortisol, etc. Liver also helps in temperature regulation of the body. Now, let us see the importance of bile and gallbladder in human body. Bile can be defined as a digestive juice that is continuously formed by the hepatocytes. The bile that is produced in the liver is poured into the bile canal equally, and from where it flows into the common hepatic duct and ultimately into the common bile duct and stored in the gallbladder. During the interdigestive period, that is when the process of digestion is not happening, bile is directed towards the gallbladder and it is stored and concentrated there. While during the time of digestion, when the chyme reaches the duodenum, hormone cholecystokinin causes contraction of the gallbladder to release bile into the duodenum. Now, look into this diagram that shows the mechanism of bile formation. Here, you can see the hepatocytes and the ductal cells that secrete fresh bile in humans. And below here, you can see how bile pigments are taken up from the blood sinusoids and are excreted into the bile canal equally by the hepatocytes. So basically what happens here is that the hepatocytes, whose one side is in contact with the blood sinusoids and the other side with the biliary canal equally, they pick up some of the constituents of bile like bile pigments from the blood and then synthesizes some of the constituents like bile salts inside the hepatocyte, and ultimately they secrete this mixture into the biliary canal equally. The bile so formed is an alkaline juice comprising of 97.6% water and 2.4% of solids. The pH of hepatic bile ranges between 7.8 to 8.6 and it is of golden yellow color. The organic substances present in bile are bile salts, bile pigments, cholesterol, fatty acids, lecithin and mucin, whereas the inorganic substances present in the bile are sodium, potassium, calcium, chlorides and bicarbonates. Since the bile produced by the liver cells flows into the common bile duct and gets stored in the gallbladder, where the bile is concentrated, there are slight differences between the properties and composition of liver bile and gallbladder bile. Here in this slide, you can easily compare between the two types of bile. For example, the pH of liver bile is more alkaline, that is 7.8 to 8.6 when compared to the pH of gallbladder bile, that is 7 to 7.6. The color of liver bile is golden yellow, while the color of gallbladder bile is blackish green. The liver bile is more watery in consistency, whereas gallbladder bile is more thicker. Now, the next topic is bile salts. Bile salts are basically sodium and potassium salts of bile acids that are conjugated with glycine or taurine. Bile salts are produced from bile acids, and bile acids can be classified into two categories, namely primary bile acids and secondary bile acids. Primary bile acids are formed in the liver cells by utilizing the cholesterol, and two examples of primary bile acids are cholic acid and quinodeoxycholic acid, whereas secondary bile acids are formed in the colon by the action of intestinal bacteria on the primary bile acids, and two examples of that are deoxycholic acid and lithocholic acid. Now, this diagram will give you a much clearer view about the formation of bile salts. Inside the hepatocytes, cholesterol is utilized to form cholic acid and quinodeoxycholic acid. Inside hepatocytes, these bile acids undergo a process called as conjugation with glycine or taurine and forms conjugated bile acids, namely glycocholic acid or taurocholic acid. Now, further, these conjugated bile acids combines with sodium or potassium salts to finally produce bile salts, namely sodium glycocholate or sodium taurocholate. The gastrointestinal tract has a unique type of circulation called as enterohepatic circulation. In simple words, it means that the flow of blood from the liver to the intestine and back to the liver. So, in scientific terms, enterohepatic circulation means the recirculation of bile salts from the liver to the small intestine and back again to the liver. Here, in this diagram, you can see that the bile juice which is freshly produced by the hepatocytes are secreted into the duodenum during the digestive phase. This bile juice is utilized for the digestion of fat and some of the bile juice flows down with the chyme till the ileum. Now, around 90 to 95% of the bile juice is reabsorbed into the portal circulation and from this terminal part of the ileum, and this portal circulation takes back this bile back to the liver, where the liver first extracts it and then again secretes some of it into the bile. The remaining 5% of the bile is excreted into the feces. Now you know very well about the formation and flow of bile salts and bile juice. So let us see the functions of bile salts. The very first and important function of bile salt is that it helps in the emulsification of fats. Without bile salts, fat droplets cannot be broken down into smaller forms and cannot be digested by the body. Thus, bile salts are essential for fat digestion. Bile salt accelerates the action of enzyme pancreatic lipase and helps in the digestion of fats. Bile salts play an important role in absorption of fats also by a process called as micelle formation. Micelles are basically the water-soluble disc-shaped particles that are formed by the combination of bile salts and products of hydrolyzed triglycerides. Since micelles are water-soluble, they tremendously help in the absorption of emulsified fats by the body. Bile salts also helps in the absorption of fat-soluble vitamins like vitamin A, D, E, and K. Bile salts acts as cholerytic as well as cholalog agents by stimulating the release of bile from the liver and stimulating release of bile from the gallbladder respectively. Bile salts helps to prevent formation of cholesterol-rich gallstones, and bile salts are also indirectly it helps in smooth defecation. Just like bile salts, bile pigments are also a component of liver and gallbladder bile. The two principal bile pigments are bilirubin and biliverdin. These are the metabolites of hemoglobin formed in the liver which are responsible for giving the liver bile its golden yellow color. Bile pigments have got no digestive function, but the abnormal increase in the blood serum concentration will show a serious disorder of liver or the biliary drug duct called as jaundice. Apart from this, when the bile pigment is broken down by the gut bacteria, it produces a brown color pigment called as urobilinogen or stercobilinogen that gives the stools its brown color. Now come to the next topic, gallbladder and its functions. As you already know that gallbladder is a thin walled sac like structure that stores the bile produced by the liver. Gallbladder can store about 50 ml of bile and it is non-essential for life. That is, one can go for the removal of gallbladder and still can easily digest and absorb fats after the removal. Let us see the functions of gallbladder in human body. First function, you all know very well that it acts as a reservoir for storage of bile. The bile formed by the liver cells is concentrated inside the gallbladder and it becomes more thicker, viscous and darker in color. Inside gallbladder, due to rapid absorption of bicarbonates, sodium and chloride ions, the bile becomes less alkaline compared to that of the liver bile. Gallbladder also secrete mucin that helps in easy passage of chyme in the intestine. Gallbladder regulates the pressure of the extrahepatic biliary system by continuously absorbing water from the stored bile. Now let us have a brief knowledge about the disorders of liver and gallbladder. The common disorders of liver are jaundice, cirrhosis of liver, and hepatitis. Jaundice is the yellow discoloration of skin and mucous membrane due to increased bilirubin concentration in blood. I have separately made a lecture on jaundice that describes all the aspects of it. I will share the link to that video in the comment box. You are advised to go see the video and gain knowledge. The second disorder of liver is cirrhosis. Cirrhosis is an irreversible chronic damage to the liver cells with extensive fibrosis and formation of nodules in the liver. The causes for liver cirrhosis can be infections, retention of bile in the liver due to obstruction of ducts of biliary system. It can be due to enlargement of liver due to intoxication, especially in cases of chronic alcoholics. Sometimes inflammation around the liver can lead to cirrhosis, and a fatty liver will lead to liver cirrhosis. The person suffering from cirrhosis of liver will experience jaundice, edema, metabolic disorders, portal hypertension, and in later stages will experience ascites and hepatic encephalopathy. The next common liver disorder is hepatitis. It can be defined as inflammation of liver cells caused by a certain group of viruses. The viruses that causes hepatitis are hepatitis A, B, C, D, or E virus. Hepatitis B is more commonly seen. The sources for getting infected with hepatitis B infection are by use of infected injections or infected blood, by the use of tattoo, acupuncture needles that are already infected with hepatitis B virus. It can spread via unprotected sexual contacts and also from an infected mother to the baby. The clinical features of viral hepatitis will include symptoms like anorexia, fever, malaise, yellow discoloration of urine, eyes and skin, that is jaundice. On examination, the liver will be seen to be enlarged and the serum alkaline phosphatase, that is SGPT and SGOT levels, will be highly increased. What is the treatment? It is strict bed rest and ingestion of high carbohydrate diet plus symptomatic treatment. The best way to avoid this condition is by getting vaccinated against the hepatitis B virus. Now, let us see the common disorders of gallbladder. Gallstones are the most common disease of gallbladder. Gallstones are solid crystal deposits that are formed by cholesterol, calcium ions, and bile pigments in the gallbladder or in the bile duct. Causes of gallstones are reduction in bile salts and or lecithin, excess of cholesterol or calcium ions, disturbed cholesterol metabolism in the body, damage or infection of the gallbladder epithelium, or obstruction of bile flow from the gallbladder. Now, there are two types of gallstones, namely cholesterol stones and pigment stones. Around 80 to 85% of the gallstone cases are of cholesterol stone type. These stones are radiolucent, that is, they cannot be seen on an X-ray film. Whereas pigment stones are less common and these are radio-opaque, that is, they can be visualized in an X-ray film. The signs and symptoms of gallbladder stones varies in people depending upon the condition. People suffering may be asymptomatic or may produce mild to moderate or severe symptoms. The most specific and characteristic symptom of gallbladder stone is biliary colic, that is pain. Other symptoms may also accompany biliary colic like nausea or vomiting, abdominal bloating and indigestion. Treatment is cholecystectomy, that is surgical removal of the gallbladder. It can be done nowadays by laparoscopy. The next topic of today's lecture is exocrine pancreas. Here, you will get a brief idea about the anatomy of pancreas, the secretions of pancreas that contains important enzymes for the digestion of food. Pancreas is an elongated accessory digestive gland. See this yellow colored organ? This is the pancreas. So, it is an accessory digestive gland that lies retroperitoneally and transversely across the posterior abdominal wall, posterior to the stomach and in between the duodenum and the spleen. Anatomically, pancreas can be divided into a head, a neck, a body and a tail, whereas physiologically, pancreas can be divided into two parts. The exocrine part of pancreas and the endocrine part of the pancreas. The exocrine part of pancreas, which we will be focusing here in today's lecture, secretes a very important digestive juice called as the pancreatic juice. This juice contains many enzymes that are capable of hydrolyzing proteins, fats, and carbohydrates present in the food. The endocrine part of the pancreas comprises of islets of Langerhans that produces hormones, namely insulin, glucagon, and somatostatin. The pancreatic juice is a transparent, colorless fluid that has a pH of 7.8 to 8.4, that is, it is alkaline in nature. The daily secretion of pancreatic juice is around 1.2 to 1.5 liters. Pancreatic juice is made up of 99.5% water and only 0.5% of solids. Here in this flowchart, you can see the various organic and inorganic substances that are present in pancreatic juice. The pancreatic acini secretes four major types of enzymes: proteolytic enzymes, lipolytic enzymes, amylolytic enzymes, and an inhibitor protein known as a trypsin inhibitor. The proteolytic enzymes like trypsin, chymotrypsin, etc. are produced in inactive forms that are activated in the duodenum and helps in the digestion of proteins. Similarly, the lipolytic enzymes like pancreatic lipase, phospholipase, A and B, etc. are activated and they help in the digestion of fats. The amylolytic enzymes like pancreatic amylase helps in the digestion of carbohydrates. And the trypsin inhibitor that is also produced by the pancreas helps in protecting the pancreas from autodigestion or self-digestion. Other inorganic substances produced by the pancreas are sodium, calcium, potassium, magnesium, bicarbonates, chlorides, phosphates, and sulfates. As far as the functions of pancreatic juice is concerned, you must remember that pancreas contributes tremendously in digestion of proteins, carbohydrates, and fats by secreting pancreatic enzymes. It also helps greatly in neutralizing the gastric HCl in the duodenum due to its high alkaline nature of the pancreatic juice. Pancreas thus also protects the intestine from the destructive action of the stomach acid. Now, briefly understand the regulation of pancreatic secretions. Secretion of pancreatic juice is regulated by both nervous and hormonal factors. The nervous control is via the stimulation of vagus nerve, whereas the hormonal control is exerted by two gastrointestinal hormones, namely cholecystokinin and secretin. The first gastrointestinal hormone that regulates pancreatic juice secretion is secretin. Secretin is secreted by the S cells present on the mucous membranes of duodenum and jejunum. Whenever there is presence of HCl or acid in the upper part of the small intestine, secretin is released by the S cells. Secretin is released into the small intestine in an inactive form, like most other enzymes and hormones of the gastrointestinal tract, and later it is converted into an active form by the gastric acid. Secretin has got many important actions. Some of the actions of secretin are: secretin acts on the pancreatic ductal cells to produce large amounts of pancreatic secretions rich in bicarbonates. Secretin also stimulates the secretion of bile. Secretin acts synergistically with cholecystokinin and it potentiates the effects of cholecystokinin on the pancreas. The action of cholecystokinin will cause contraction of gallbladder and it will release bile, and also cholecystokinin will cause contraction of the pyloric sphincter and it will delay the gastric emptying. The second gastrointestinal hormone that regulates pancreatic secretion is cholecystokinin. It is secreted by the eye cells of mucosa of duodenum and jejunum. The presence of amino acids, fatty acids, monoglycerides in the small intestinal chyme will stimulate eye cells to release cholecystokinin. The various actions of cholecystokinin are: it causes secretion of the enzyme-rich part of the pancreatic juice. It contracts the gallbladder and helps the release of bile juice. Cholecystokinin works synergistically with secretin hormone and potentiates the effects of secretin hormone. It also increases the gut motility and inhibits gastric emptying. So that's all for today's lecture. Thank you.